So my name is Camilla Fitzsimons. I presume, as I was introduced, it was explained that I work in the Department of Adult and Community Education in Ireland in Maynooth University. So we are a department that most of our students would be what we would call non-traditional in Ireland. So most of our students are mature students or students who wouldn't traditionally have a background in university attendance. So Lilian, would you like to say hello and tell people who you are?
So hello, thank you, Camilla. And hello, everyone. It's such an honor to be here. My name is Lilian Nwanze. I'm a doctoral student at the Maynooth University. My research is on the impact racism has on women in education. So it's such an honor to be here. I'll pass this back to Camilla now.
So just to explain a little bit about how we're going to do things. So we're not actually going to use a PowerPoint until the very end, when we have just three slides that we hope will bring some of our thinking together. What we are going to do before that is we're both really just going to share some stories or some examples from our own lives, which really speak to the topic that we're being asked to address, which is ideas around structural racism, how they impact all of our lives, and then how we might behave differently as educators in classrooms in order to be open and honest about certain privileges that some of us hold and address the ways in which racism can permeate really every aspect of the world that we live in. So I'm going to hand over to Lilian, who's going to share some of her own stories around education in Ireland. I will then share some stories. And as I say, we'll then back this up with a very short piece of theory. What I would encourage you to do in the meantime is feel free to just make your own notes. Have a think about what we're saying and think about not what we're saying, but think about moments and times when this kind of, you know, knocks off some of your own experience in life and some of your own story in terms of racialization. So Lilian, over to you.
Thank you, Camilla. I want to tell a story of two classrooms. I've been in Ireland for nine years. And in those 9 years, I've enrolled and completed at least three courses within two universities. My story centers around my experience in two of those classrooms. I'll call them Classroom A and Classroom B. Classroom A, I had just come into the country from Nigeria. I cannot say I had really settled. It had been one full year and I was still far from adjusting to food, to the weather, to the new accent, to life in general. I was still culture shocked. I had no friends. I felt trapped because I was coming from a very active professional life, and suddenly everything had stopped. No job, no friends, no networks. I was starting again. And as flippant as I make this sound, it was a big deal for me. Had I not had a faith in God, I would probably have caved in. So you can imagine my joy when it was time to resume at one of the universities in Ireland. I was elated. I knew the exposure, the broadening, the sense of fulfillment engaging in academics could bring. So I was really excited. I started the course. The teachers were fantastic. They knew what they were doing. The course content was very good, but I was invisible. No one spoke to me. I spoke to no one. Honestly, I was afraid to even speak to anyone. Even though I was doing a master's in international and European business law, International obviously meant American and British, because there was no reference to Africa. There was no reference to anything familiar. I was always the last to be chosen by my peers to belong in a group. And even when I was chosen, I was never chosen to speak. I never shared anything in that classroom, even when I knew things to say that could help what the teacher was saying. I just came into the class and went home. I was invisible. 5 years after my experience with Classroom A, I enrolled for another course and encountered Classroom B. From the first day I stepped into that class, I was drawn into a discussion. Notice my phrase, drawn in. I wanted to hide. I was not allowed to hide. In the first few days when groups were formed, myself and the other African girl in class were again left to ourselves. But within a week of attending, that miraculously changed. People actually spoke to me. Teachers knew my name. I was able to tell them things about my life because they really wanted to know. They knew when, for instance, I became an Irish citizen. And the class actually took a break to celebrate me. I existed in the minds of these guys. We shared biographic stories in class. People were learning about where I came from. I too was learning things about Ireland that I had not learned in the 6 years I had been in the country. We were doing heavy coursework, so there was actual learning in those classrooms. But it was like community. Everyone respected me. We were able to have tough discussions about race, class, gender, and while we argued ferociously sometimes, we made up afterwards. I recall an incident where we were discussing race and a white male in the class flippantly made a comment that racism only existed in the heads of Black people or people of color. Ordinarily, I would have ignored that. But that day, something in me broke. I began to recount the countless amount of times that doors were shut in my face when I was qualified just because I was Black. Suddenly, all the years of applying for jobs without even an acknowledgement from the employer flashed through my mind. And I responded to that man, and I responded more emotively than I should have. I remember that day after the class, I went home feeling tired, feeling almost hopeless. And as I got home, I received a call from a strange number. I picked up the call, and it was the facilitator of the class. I had not told her that I was feeling low. I hadn't told her that I was feeling emotionally drained, but she knew, and she called to check up on me. For me, it showed that I mattered. That class had become like my family, and I eventually and finally now had a place in that family. It took reflection on my part and exposure to theory to make me realize that classroom B did not just happen because the students were friendly or because the teachers were nicer. Classroom B had the effect it had because the facilitators had embraced and worked from a particular framework. I wasn't suddenly included in groups because the students had an aha moment. No, I was included because the facilitation style and the ideology behind that style compelled my inclusion. The community that Classroom B had become did not just form by chance. There was intention behind it. Even though I graduated from both Classroom A and Classroom B with good grades, I often say now that I would not trade my experience in Classroom B for anything in the world. It is my hope that by the end of our presentation, Camilla and I, and all of us here, may be able to discuss some of the techniques that created for the atmosphere in Classroom B. I'll hand this back to Camilla now for her own story. Thank you.
Thanks, Lilian. It's lovely to listen to you talk about, certainly about Classroom B. I'm not sure if it's nice for you to remember your first experience. I suppose what I'm going to talk about now is really from the other side of the fence in some respects. So I'm going to talk a little bit about my own story of being a white adult educator and somebody who for quite a long interest has had an interest in diversity and in, you know, creating a more equal world. And I think it's important to think back to my own journey into that work, which really began probably about 10 or 15 years ago when Ireland was changing. So you heard Lillian talk about her own story of moving to Ireland as a migrant. You know, another way that Ireland differs from other European countries is that migration into Ireland is something that has happened much more recently than in other European countries. For many, many years, we were the people who left. We were the people who moved all over the world. And it is only with it really from the 1990s onwards that people have started to move to Ireland and that we have begun to create a society that is visibly more diverse in terms of the colour of people's skin, essentially. So when I started working around, you know, responding to this new Ireland, I started doing work around interculturalism and the notion of creating intercultural environments where, you know, together people could make sense of the newness of Ireland and where we could really embrace our new citizens and new people moving into the country. And this worked for a while, but then I started to feel increasingly uncomfortable about the approach. So some things happened. One thing I remember was this kind of scramble for participants of colour. So, you know, how do we get them to come to our courses? It was very much a starting point. If we did then get a mixed group, it was really a sense of, you know, drawing out differences amongst the group. So this focus on cultural difference, not to discount cultural differences, and I mean, Lilian has already mentioned the kind of disorienting approach or disorienting impact it can have. But I felt in some of these education environments, the differences were being overplayed and an othering was happening to new Irish people. And really a sense, an unnamed sense, that the dominant culture, the Irish culture, essentially, the old Irish culture, was the normal way to be. And anything else was different, or, and not just different, was less than the dominant culture. So initially I didn't know what to do about this discomfort, but then I started to think more deliberately about my own racialization, my whiteness, the color of my own skin, and how that impacts the way I am in the world. And I started reading about privilege, reading people, Peggy McIntosh has obviously done writing, Frances Kendall as well, American contributors who started to think about racialization in a very, very different way, and encouraged people like me to think about the ways in which, although I present this very welcoming approach, that when push comes to shove, or when I'm in a spot of bother, when are the times that I actually lean on my privilege in a way that other people can't do? So one of the first articles I wrote about this kind of changing perspective that I was taking is an article called Being a White Adult Educator. And I tell a story within that article about a time when one of my children was in a shopping center quite local to where I live with her friend, a childhood friend that she's had all her life. The childhood friend has a parent from North Africa, so is dark skinned. My daughter is white and has red hair, so very, very Irish looking. And they were caught shoplifting. So this was their teenage fun for the day. And the police became involved in the situation. So I had to get the bus up. I had to collect my daughter. And the first thing that she said to me, so she was, I think, 15, 16 at the time, was that both of the young women or young girls had noticed that the policeman behaved differently to the racialized girl who had never been outside of Ireland her whole life. She was as Irish as my daughter, but she had been asked different questions. She had been asked, where was she from? She had been asked about her background in a way that my child hadn't. And this was something that my own child noticed as, for the first time really, in her whole life. She noticed she had seen other people behave differently to her friend, but this was the first time she'd really seen an authority source behave in this different way. So I had this wonderful conversation with her about how wrong the policeman was and how, you know, equality is the way to go. But what happened next is really the piece that I want to focus on the most, which is about a month later. In closing this case, a community policeman, a community guard, as they're called in Ireland, called to my house to meet my daughter with her parents and really just, as I say, close the case and put an end to the situation. And this is when I leant on my privilege. Quite deliberately, if I'm honest about it. So I put on my best middle class face. I said the things I knew the policeman wanted me to say. At one stage, he spoke quite negatively about working class children, about those other children and the way they behave and their parents that don't agree with them or that don't support them. And even though on the inside, I was very uncomfortable, my goal was to get him out of the house as quickly as I could, everybody friends, so that my daughter would be free from police interference in her life and would have no record of this. So that's what I did. I leaned on my privilege, everybody shook hands, and off he went. So the reason that story is important is that people who encourage that naming of privilege say that we need to do that in education space also, that I need to be open and honest about times when I have behaved like that, that I need to look back on my life and pinpoint the different moments where I leaned on privilege. And there's justifiable reasons why I did, obviously, but that helps me to see how other people don't have that same opportunity, don't have that advantage of leaning on privilege. And it is from that starting point that I seek to create education environments that begin where the white educator, be that me, acknowledges my privilege. Now, it's not to say that much broader structural inequality isn't important. I mean, Lilian has heard me say this before. I'm not Jeff Bezos. I can't take responsibility for much wider ways in which racialization connects with broader capitalist structures of inequality. But I can be honest that it is a factor in my life. I can be honest about that. And only then can I create the sort of learning environments that Lilian has described. So what I'm going to do now, I think I have permission to share my screen. I think I will need whoever's sharing that screen already to unshare, if that's okay. And I'm not sure now if you can give me permission.
Yeah, I think you have the permission.
Great. Yes, you have it.
Yes.
So can you see that?
Yes, we do.
So just before I keep going, just take a minute. Think about your own thoughts on what you've heard so far. And think about your own experiences of inclusion and exclusion. So mine was a story of inclusion in the minds of the judiciary, essentially represented through a policeman in my life. Lilian shared a story of exclusion, which really is not a deliberate, very obvious exclusion, but it is an exclusion by conditions not being created to deliberately include her. So this is a form of exclusion also. And think for yourselves about ways that more can be done in your own classrooms, for those of you who work in classrooms or in your own groups, be they family groups, social groups, for people who are involved in other groups. And just to bring some theory in. So Lilian and I are leaning on some theoretical ideas from Stephen Brookfield, who's a British academic based in the United States now, who has written a lot about white people like me and how I should think about, talk about, and teach race. And he sees this as being a key way to unmask and challenge racism. So really it's turning some ideas about racism on their head. Racism is not the person shouting abuse across the street. Racism is something that is stitched into the fabric of our society that many of us, perhaps all of us, Stephen Brookfield would argue, unwittingly reproduce all the time. So he suggests particular ways to approach adult education, and one I've already talked about, which is this notion of scaffolding. So Stephen Brookfield suggests that the starting point is to start where people are at. So to understand that many white people begin from a space of colour blindness, which often is linked to a real commitment to equality. So people think, well, the best way is just to treat everybody the same. If I'm just don't make any changes, that's equality. And that is often what I hear in that classroom aid that Lillian talks about. But this doesn't work when you think about the way that the world is structured in such an unequal way. So it doesn't work to pretend that those differences aren't there. So he says, start by sharing a story, maybe not as dramatic as mine, around police being involved in your life, but something that even in a very small way acknowledges your own privilege if you are a person who's white. The second thing Stephen Brookfield encourages to do, and it doesn't matter what you're teaching, you could be teaching biology, you could be teaching sociology, you could be talking about any topic in any professional space, but he talks about normalizing the idea that racial injustice exists, making it unremarkable. So one of the examples he uses is when Nelson Mandela, obviously possibly one of the greatest freedom fighters in terms of racial inequality in the world, that he tells a story in his own biography where he gets on an airplane flying overseas. At this stage, he's released from prison and he's a very, obviously a very recognizable figure in the world. He sees that the pilot is black and he panics. And Nelson Mandela thinks, oh my God, we're going to crash. Because even he had internalized dominant ideas that white people are more rational, safer pair of hands, less emotional. Even Nelson Mandela had internalized that. So Stephen Brookfield says we need to normalize it and not be ashamed of it or afraid to acknowledge just how interpolated these ideas are from the moment that many of that were born, essentially. He also then encourages us to build community. So that classroom B that Lillian describes. So create, deliberately work to create environments where people feel safe, where there's solidarity, where people feel significant. And I think Lillian has already described the participatory method that he encourages. But he kind of warns us as well. And for me, this is a really important part of his thinking, is to avoid what he calls repressive tolerance. Sometimes in Ireland, we call this the diversity smile. So this is where there's a veneer of change. So this is where people of color are invited into photographs for brochures. This is where there can be quotas even on admission, where there can be sometimes quite high profile appointments of people of color. And then the sense is, job is done. Actually, this can make things a lot worse for people of color, particularly when you're being called left, right, and center to be in photo ops. And when in your own life, nothing else is particularly changing. So classroom A is still happening. And actually, you're interrupted from whatever education you can have. This is actually quite funnily played out in the television show Shameless, if anybody has seen it, where the child keeps getting pulled from class to be in these photo ops and is missing missing the opportunity to be part of a community. So this is just something that Stephen Brookfield alerts us to. And again, people can be well-intentioned and some of these changes are important that they're made, but not when the only change that happens is on the surface and when white people like me don't take the time to really look at our own role in reproducing racial inequality. So Lillian, I think you are going to speak to the next slide. Do you want me to go to the next one?
Yes, please. Thank you. So I think that just as we close or prepare to close, I think that oftentimes when people think about racism, think in terms of the harm suffered by the Black person or the minority ethnic person.
Lilian, your sound is the sound off for other people also. I don't know if you want to turn off
anyone here.
Yeah, the sound is quite bad. May I please ask everybody else but Lilian to turn off the microphone? Maybe this might help. And may I please ask the two of you, I'm so very sorry. We are running out of time. We only have 1 more minute, please.
This is the last slide.
Thank you very much.
So, is my sound better now?
No, it's still a bad sound. Sorry.
Turn off the video, Lilian.
Sorry?
Maybe turn off your video.
Can you hear me now? Is it any better?
We hear you, but the voice isn't better. No, there is some strange echo.
So I will continue.
Yes.
So this is our last slide. And really, it's just to reiterate what we're saying. We exist within, Lilian would explain this much better. But we exist within a system of privilege where these are two sides to the one coin. You cannot separate the experiences for people of color from the experiences of white people and the privileges that they hold. And in order to achieve balance, we have to have action from both ends. So I think we leave it there, Lilian. I hope that was useful, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to share some of our ideas.